Hello, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Exotic Astrology. And finally, it's Makar Sankranti. Sun is moving into the sign of Capricorn, and it's a moment of celebration everywhere in India and the Indian community in almost every part of this world. So, congratulations to all those who are performing some programs, singing, dancing, and also to those who will just enjoy this festival by eating and by delighting in all the religious traditions. All right, so let us see what we could meditate during this festival, because this is a very important festival, because this marks the beginning of Uttarayan. All right, so this festival is very, very, very important, because today we are going to discuss about one such great, great, great personality who had departed from this world during this time. And yes, you guessed it right. So, once upon a time, when the Kurukshetra war was over, yes, for the Western audience, we are talking of the Mahabharata here. So, when the Kurukshetra war was finally over, the fratricidal war, where the Pandavas had finally emerged victorious after all the trials and tribulations. And finally, when Duryodhana was defeated and Dhritarashtra was on the verge of surrender, then finally, when this battle was over, and when the sons of Draupadi were brutally murdered in the dead of the night by Ashwatthama, so that is the Sauptik Parva, where everybody is crying because the sons of Draupadi are no more. Okay, so then we have different parvas later on also. Shanti Parva is there. Then we have Anushasan Parva, that is also there. So now, once this war is over, as you see, before the war begins, Arjuna is one such personality who is not very keen to fight this war, because Krishna has to push him to fight the war. He doesn't want to fight, because the Bhagavad Gita says that that is one of the symptoms of a great soul, of a great personality, that he doesn't like violence, he doesn't like hatred, he doesn't like to give suffering to others. But Krishna told Arjuna that those people to whom you are showing your compassion, they are not worthy of your compassion. If they remain in this world, then they will destroy everything. They will destroy all culture, all religion, all traditions. Everything will be finished. So they must be killed. If they are not killed, then they will kill you and everybody else. So therefore, Arjuna, don't misplace your compassion. But still, a great soul is even then very compassionate. So Arjuna was one such person who was feeling very bad before the war, and after the war, there was another personality who was feeling very bad. Yes, you guessed it right. He was none other than Yudhishthir Maharaj himself. So Dharmaraj Yudhishthir, he was also feeling very bad, because he's also a great soul. He was feeling that because of his hunger and desire for power and authority, this war happened, and because of that, all the Kauravas perished, including his own children. So he was so much disheartened, he was so devastated, he was tormented inside by these feelings of guilt and helplessness, hopelessness. He used to constantly think that he is the culprit, because he had the desire to be sitting in the throne as a king. And then Krishna came, And Krishna came there and he tried to explain to him that, my dear Yudhishthira Maharaj, it is not like that. It is not that you are selfish, and because of your selfishness, this war happened. This war was the need of the hour. And then Yudhishthira Maharaj is like, no, no, no. It is my selfishness. Because of my selfishness, selfish desires, this war happened. And then Krishna had requested the great sage Maharishi Vyasdev to come and console Yudhishthira Maharaj. But all the words of Krishna and Maharishi Vyas fell in deaf ears. Yudhishthira Maharaj was not convinced. And finally, as Lord Krishna says in the Gita, Ishvara Sarva Bhutanam Hriddeshe Arjuna Tishtati, that I am situated in everybody's heart. And as the Paramatma, he tried to convince Yudhishthira Maharaj that you are not responsible for this war. It was the need of the hour. It had to be done. And that's what Krishna says in the Gita. Yada yada hi dharmasya glaner bhavati bharata. Abhyuthanam adharmasya tadatmanam srijamyaham. So there are some foolish people in this Kali Yuga who accuse Lord Krishna sometimes, you know. They are headless, totally without brains and logic. So they say that, oh, Krishna was not God actually, you know, because if he was God, he could have stopped this war. Well, what if I told you he incarnated only for, you know, wiping these crooks out of this world? Yes, especially Duryodhana, Karna, Shakuni, Dushasan, and Dhritarashtra, and all these are crooks of the highest order. There is nothing, there is no sin which they have not committed, you know. From trying to kill Bhima when he was young, you know, from trying to disrobe Draupadi, trying to insult her, you know, calling Draupadi a harlot, then cheating Yudhishthira Maharaj. These are all the grievous sins, you know. For example, there are six aggressors, they say in the scriptures, you know, six kind of atatais. And these crooks, the Kauravas, Duryodhana and company, they qualify for all these six aggressors. So the scriptures say that these atatais, they have to be killed at once. No discussions, no arguments, no questions. Whenever you see them, however you see them, just rip their head off. That's it. No questions, no law, no justice for them, because they are the highest of the crooks. But, and that is why Krishna, he ensured that that Mother Earth drinks the blood of these crooks. And this is very true, because when Krishna is about to go as the Shanti Dut, you know, to Hastinapur, then Draupadi asks to Lord Krishna that, oh Krishna, you are going as Shanti Dut, as the messenger of peace. And if you go as the messenger of peace, of course, you can speak in a way that others are convinced, and they will agree for peace, you know. And then Draupadi says, but what will happen to the injustice that happened to me? Who will give justice to me? And then Krishna says to Draupadi very clearly, he says that, my dear Draupadi, although I am going and I will do my duty, my dharma, to speak, but I don't force anybody to listen to me. Not that he cannot, but he does not, because that is his free will. You know, he gives free will to others. So, but don't worry. Duryodhana and his company, Duryodhana and company, these crooks will never listen to me, because they're crooks basically. Even if they want to, the others will not let them listen. Even if Duryodhana is good, then Shakuni will say, now, whoa, what nonsense, how can you surrender to the Pandavas? You forgot what they did to you, blah, 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 blah. And if Shakuni agrees, then Dushasan will not agree. Because they are criminals, basically. That's how their psychology works. They are motivating each other towards hell. And therefore, don't worry. Mother Earth will drink the blood of these sinful rascals. This is what Krishna says to Draupadi. And then that's what happens, you know, all of these criminals, they meet their end, very vicious ends. And then what happens? Yudhishthir Maharaj is getting this inspiration from inside to inquire about higher reality. And then Krishna tells to Yudhishthir Maharaj that now is the time that you should focus on being a very great king, and let us start the procedure for that. And then very soon, one day, Krishna is there in his room, and Yudhishthir Maharaj goes inside. And Yudhishthir Maharaj goes and sees Krishna is, his eyes are closed, you know, he's meditating, he's in trance. But it's a very peculiar kind of trance. Lord Krishna, when he was meditating, then he was also smiling. Generally, you don't see yogis smiling. Or anybody who is meditating, generally they are, you know, they're like neutral. They are not happy, they are not sad. But Krishna was smiling. There was a divine smile on his face. And then Yudhishthir Maharaj was amazed to see this. The Yudhishthir Maharaj asked Lord Krishna that, my dear Krishna, can you tell me who is that upon whom you are meditating? Yes? Because the entire world, all the yogis, they are meditating on you. Yam Brahma Varunendra Rudra Marutas Tunabanti Divya Istavai. No, who are you meditating upon? May I know who is that great personality upon whom you are meditating? And then Krishna does not answer. He's still going on smiling in his trance. And then Yudhishthir Maharaj, he realizes that this is really a serious business. Krishna is doing something really very serious. And then Yudhishthir Maharaj's amazement changes to, you know, awe and reverence and respect. And he again requests Krishna very humbly this time. He says, oh Keshava, if I am fortunate enough, can you please enlighten me? I also want to know, you know, who is that personality upon whom you are meditating? Please enlighten me. What is so special about that person that you yourself are engrossed in meditating about him? Please enlighten me. And Yudhishthir Maharaj chants a lot of prayers. You know, he says, oh, cause of all causes, you know, as the Brahma Samhita says, you know, Ishvara Parama Krishna Satchidananda Vigraha Anadir Adir Govinda Sarva Karana Karanam Chintamani Prakara Sadma Sukalpa Vriksha Laksha Vriteshu Surabhira Vipalayantam Lakshmi Sastra Satasambra Masevya Manam Govindamadi Purusham Tamaham Bajami Angani Asya Sakalendri Avritti Manti. So Yudhishthir Maharaj then requests Krishna, and then finally Krishna opens his eyes, and there is a divine peace which is emanating out from Krishna's body during that time. And Yudhishthir Maharaj is amazed to see this, and he asks Krishna, can I please know who is that great personality upon whom you are meditating? And then Krishna says, yes, I am meditating upon your grandfather, upon Bhishma Pitama, Bhishma Dev, who is in his last days in the arrow bed, you know, as they say, you know, in his Shaya. Shaya is the bed, but that is a bed of arrows, you know, Shar Shaya, they say. In Asmis, they say, you know, Horofajja. So he is there in his last days, and we must go and take his association, because very soon he will depart from this world. And when that great personality departs, a world of culture, knowledge, wisdom, and divinity will also depart with him. So let us not waste further time, and let us go and meet him. You know, and when Yudhishthir Maharaj heard of Bhishma, he was even more devastated. You know, he was even more disheartened. He was even more hopeless, because he thought, you know, oh yes, again, because of me, you know, our grandfather is lying like that in the battlefield. His body was full of arrows, as we all know. But he had the boon of Ichhan Mityu. That is why he was alive. And then finally, Krishna instructs the Pandavas and Draupadi that although we are going to meet somebody who is on the verge of death, who is about to leave his body, but that personality could have left his body long, long, long time back. When he had seen crooks like Dhritarashtra and Duryodhan sitting in the throne, he could have said, enough is enough. I don't want to stay here. You know, this is a filthy, disgusting place called Hastinapur where these criminals are sitting in the throne. I don't wish to be a part of these. I don't want to stay with them. He could have done it, but he did not, because he knew that eventually one day dharma will win. Dharma triumphs. As Mahabharata says, you know, dharmo rakshati rakshitaha. Dharma protects one who adheres to it. So the Pandavas especially, they are pillars of dharma, and that is why they were victorious at the end. And Bhishma Pitama, although he would have left, he had seen so many wrong things, so many injustices with the Pandavas, but he still lived to see this divine day, to finally see Yudhishthir Maharaj being coronated as the emperor of the entire world, or you could say the entire universe. And he wanted to experience this joy of finally Dharma and Krishna and his devotees being celebrated throughout the universe. And that is why he kept living. He did not leave his body, although he could have done on the day one itself, you know, when he was in the arrow bed, of course, on the 10th day of the Kurukshetra war. And then finally, Krishna instructs Yudhishthira Maharaj and the Pandavas and Draupadi to dress in royal garments, you know, as kings and as queens and very affluent, you know, members of the royal family, so that Bhishma is very pleased to see them. Because this was the day for which Bhishma was living till now. And then finally, Yudhishthira Maharaj and Draupadi and so many other great personalities, they come and they meet Bhishma Pitama. And in the first canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, there's a detailed description of the things which Bhishma Pitama speaks during that time. All right. So please take out the first canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam and please read it. And Bhishma, as we know, he is also one of the 12 Mahajans. Swayambhu Narada Shambhu Kumaro Kapilo Manu Prahlado Janako Bhishmo Balir Vyasakhi Vayam. These are the 12 Mahajans which Yamaraj tells to his Yamadutas in the story of Ajamil in the Srimad Bhagavatam. And Bhishma is one of them. So he is one of the 12 Mahajans. Mahajans are great personalities who teaches us, who sets an example for us to follow. So whenever we have any doubt on any scriptural principle, we just see the life of these Mahajans, you know, these 12 Mahajans. So when we see the lives of these Mahajans, then we understand what real dharma is, what is spirituality, what is sacrifice. And then all the Pandavas, including Krishna and Draupadi and Kunti also, they come to Bhishma Pitama. And then when Bhishma sees all these personalities, he's extremely happy. He's delighted. And then when he sees Krishna, he starts smiling. He says that, oh, Keshava, you are so great that knowing that the time of my departure has come, you have come here, you know, to give your darshan to me. I'm so delighted to see you and all the Pandavas. And then Krishna says, and then Bhishma says to Krishna, oh Krishna, what before I leave, what is that which I can do for you? What service can I offer to you? Please instruct me. Please tell me. And then Krishna tells to Bhishma that, my dear Bhishma Pitama, you must speak now. Now is the time that you speak and we listen, because you are an ocean of knowledge and spiritual wisdom, character, divinity, love, all the divine qualities. You are personification of all the qualities. So you must speak, you must enlighten your grandsons, especially Yudhishthir Maharaj and Arjun and Bhim, Nakul, Sahadev and all these personalities, so that they can know what Raj Dharma is, you know, what is the dharma of a king, what a king should do, how a king should be, you know, all the different domains of this world. Please enlighten them. You have oceanic knowledge. And then Bhishma says that, O Krishna, in your presence, you are the spiritual master of the entire universe. In your presence, how can an insignificant person like me speak? And even if I'm eligible to speak, the problem is I cannot speak because I'm very tired. I'm lying in this aerobit from many days and I've not eaten anything. I did not drink anything. And my body, my voice is weak. I can't speak. I'm old and I'm on the verge of death. So I can't do this. And Krishna says that if you tell that I am the spiritual master of the entire universe, then as a spiritual master of the entire universe, I am instructing you that now you should speak. So therefore, Bhishma, please speak. And regarding your old age and pain and thirst and hunger, listen as I give you this blessing that from now on, from this very moment, you will not feel any pain in your body and your intelligence will be sharp as your youth and your voice will be like thunder. And as soon as Krishna says this, the demigods, they shower flowers from the heavens. And then Bhishma starts speaking and then his voice is like, you know, thunderbolt. It's like lightning. It is very strong. It's very sharp and his memory is right intact. And then Bhishma starts speaking. And like this, in this situation, he speaks for almost 56 days. Different editions of the Mahabharata says different days. So some say that he spoke for 50 days, some say 52, some say 48, some say 56. And for these many days, you know, imagine in that situation, he enlightened the Pandavas and Draupadi and Kunti. And then finally, one day, he says to Krishna that now the time for my departure has come. And he withdraws his consciousness inside from all the different topics that he discussed, you know? And pinpointingly, as Krishna says in the Gita, no, bahushakhaya nantascha buddha yoga avyavasayina, ekeha kurunandana, Krishna says, you know, that one pointed attention, you know, one who is determined about making spiritual progress, his attention is pinpointed, you know, single pointed. Ekeha Kuru Nandana. You know, that shloka is very famous in the Gita. So Bhishma, similarly, at the end, he withdraws himself from all this politics and, you know, all these worldly affairs and what king should do, what is economy, what is, you know, progress, what is prowess, what is dharma, what is religion. He withdraws his consciousness and focuses it towards Lord Krishna, finally at the end. And he starts glorifying Lord Krishna elaborately, which is mentioned in the first canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. And Bhishma Pitama says there that Bhishma first glorifies the beauty of Lord Krishna, that how he is beautiful, even more beautiful than millions and millions of Cupids combined, you know. As they say, you know, Kandarpa Koti Kamaniya Vishesha Shobham. And then he says, you know, that so many beautiful prayers he has. And finally, his prayer concludes with that scene, you know, where on the ninth day of the Kurukshetra war, you know, because Bhishma was fighting so valiantly, you know, and he was about to kill the Pandavas, and then Krishna had lifted a chariot wheel and he ran towards Bhishma, and Bhishma says that you are so kind that you wanted to liberate me from this hellish existence, and that is why you took the wheel of the chariot and you ran towards me. May that sight always be there in my mind. And by thinking of that scene which happened in the Kurukshetra battlefield, you know, by remembering Krishna's greatness, by remembering that Krishna is so great that because Bhishma had taken a vow that either I will kill one of the Pandavas today or I will force Krishna to lift a weapon. So to keep Bhishma's vow, Krishna broke his own promise, because Krishna had taken a vow before that I will not lift a weapon. You know, now of course Acharya say, you know, Krishna is very intelligent, he can do certain things and still not break the vow, because Krishna's vow was he will not lift a weapon, and according to the scriptures the wheel of a chariot is not considered to be a weapon. So Krishna actually did not lift any weapon, literally. So Krishna's vow was still intact, but to show the world that when I have to protect where a devotee's vow, I will not even care for my vow. So Bhishma had taken a vow that either Krishna will lift a weapon and kill me, or I will kill one of the Pandavas. And Krishna cannot see any of the Pandavas being killed because they are his great devotees, you know. So to protect them, when even Arjuna could not counter Bhishma, you know, in the ninth day of the Kurukshetra war, that Krishna broke his promise apparently, and he took the wheel of a chariot which was lying down. And then he ran towards Bhishma. His eyes were red like fire, you know, like coal, as they say, like copper sometimes. And finally, Arjuna stopped Krishna. It is said Arjuna was dragging, you know, Krishna was actually dragging Arjuna. Arjuna was catching Krishna's feet, and Arjuna said, "Please give me one more chance. I will kill Bhishma. But please don't break your vow, you know, just to protect me. Please don't do that. Because I am very concerned about what people speak about you." And Bhishma, his final point of meditation, and then also the Vishnu Sastra Naam is there, you know, Jagat Prabhum Devadevam Anantam Purushottamam. So reading the Vishnu Sastra Naam is also great today. And finally, after meditating on Krishna and his greatness and his qualities and his activities and his pastimes and his beautiful face, Bhishma departs from this world, and the great sages who are assembled there, they see that divine light came out of Bhishma's forehead, and it entered Lord Krishna's body. And then by that, they concluded that Bhishma Pitama had gone back to the spiritual world and to never ever ever return back to this material world, because Krishna says in the Gita, Yad gatva nani vartante tadhama paramam mama. And therefore they understood that Bhishma Pitama has finally left. So his departure is the most glorious. You will never find any departure. Departures of personalities like Dhruva Maharaj especially, and Bhishma Pitama, no, and Chitraketu Maharaj also to some extent, Chitraketu as the demon Vritrasura is very great. So the perfection of life is to die in a way that we never have to die again, because then we don't take birth again. Let's perfect our lives. And that was such a great moment of celebration, joy and tears and suffering also, because the Pandavas could not tolerate that, you know, their grandfather and Arjuna especially, who loved Bhishma more than anybody, you know, realizing that he was the cause of this pain which Bhishma was undergoing. But what to do? Sometimes you got to do things which are tough, even if you don't like, to maintain some higher principles, you know, if God wants at least. You know, so that is the glorious life of Bhishma Pitama, and his life has been full of struggles, pain, suffering, nothing else. He has hardly had good moments. All poison, all politics, all dirty things. And finally he left from this material world, which is like a filthy, disgusting place when it comes to the spiritual realm. All right, so Today is the perfect day for us to meditate on such personalities and pray to them and take their blessings so that we can also die in a way that, not die exactly, we can also leave this world by leaving a legacy behind and never ever to return to this material world. All right. Thank you very much for your patience and wish you a very, very, very happy Makar Sankranti to everybody and to all my Asmi's friends who are watching this. Happy Bihu. Bihu Hubesa Jonalu. All right. So wish you all the best. Enjoy. Have great food. Read the first canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. Listen to the Vishnu Sahasranam and pray to this great personality who was there in this world 5,000 years back. All right. Thank you very much.